כן, סליחה על כל הקובעים הטכניים. אוקיי, אז זה מאמר בכלכלה. I will present in English. This is my first presentation in a history conference, and I realize there are many cultural differences. So one of the differences seems to be language is an important issue. I talked to someone and who asked me which language I present. I said, I'll see, maybe Hebrew, maybe English, and she checked the program and said, no, you're presenting in English. I said, how do you know? And she said, there is an E next to the title of your paper. But I said, oh, I thought E is for economists and H for historians. So that's one cultural difference. The other one is, as you know, economists like to rely on theories. They use theories as torches to look at the reality. And this is what we are doing in this paper. So we have a theory in search of reality, and hopefully we found some historical reality that can accommodate our theoretical framework. So the topic here is about assimilation and cohesiveness in a hostile environment, theory and evidence from Jewish communities in 14th century Provence. This is joint work with Avi Weiss, who is sitting here, is from the Department of Economics at Bar-Ilan, like myself, and Juliette Sibon, who is the historian in this triplet, medieval historian from the University of Albi in Toulouse in southwestern France, so not in Provence, but she is the one who suffered the field work in Provence. And thanks to her, we also have data to somehow test our model. So I will say a few introductory words to explain to you how we came up with this topic. I know tomorrow, Wiechstein will present his book on the Chosen Few, and this book is basically about economics, economic demography of the history of the Jews. And at about the same time, the first version of their working paper with Botticini came out. We also were interested in these two basic facts that historians have been trying to explain: the fact that throughout the millennium of the Middle Ages, there was a sharp drop in the number of Jews, from 5 to 1 million, the numbers are not so important, and concentration of Jews in residential locations and urban trades. So the claim by Botticini and Eckstein was that the traditional explanations proposed by historians, and which were based on persecutions and restrictions, were not fully relevant, because especially in the Muslim world, which was more tolerant, in many instances, there were no such restrictions and persecutions. So starting from there, they suggest an explanation based on the human capital of Jews, of the decree that there is mandatory education in Judaism, and this imposes costs on being a Jew. And so either if you want to stay a Jew, then you'd better try to have some benefits, and you can get benefits if you have an occupation where education is productive, okay? And so this is how they explain the fact that you would convert if you want to stay in the rural area and live from agriculture, or if you remain a Jew because you are attached to Judaism, then you'd better move to the city and use your education in trade and some other occupations where it is productive. So we were not really directly part of this debate. What we want to do is to propose a theory which explains, quotes, is also predicting these two trends, but with some additional elements that we believe are also interesting and complementary of these things. So I give you a snapshot of predictions from the model beyond the reduction in the total population size and concentration in urban areas that you already have in Botticini and Eckstein's model. We have additional predictions, and you will see how we come with this. We've come up with these predictions. One is that you will have some rule of proportionality between the size of the Jewish community and the size of the city where the Jews live. It's not purely proportional. There is also a tendency for having a relatively bigger community in bigger cities. So this is one aspect. The other is that we think also the model generates the fact, which is also a status fact, that you had some Jews in some places and no Jews in other places. And finally, that the size of the Jewish communities was driven by the incentive to leave Judaism or not, and that this is a very important element of that was the daily trades and transactions, how they were conducted between Jews and non-Jews, and especially the role of hostility, and I will explain what we mean exactly by hostility in intergroup relations. Let me briefly sketch our model just to give you the intuition. Then we'll tell you how we think this model can be adapted to the case of a minority and a majority, in our view, Jews and Gentiles, and how we believe that maybe not a test, but at least some empirical background for this model can be drawn from the evidence we have in the 14th century Provence. So this is a game theory model. I know this is not the right forum to dig into equations, but just to give you the basic intuition, assume that you have a prisoner's dilemma. Okay, so you assume you have two groups, a minority, a majority, and they encounter and transact together. And the proportion of trades for one person is given. For example, each person has 100 transactions during a period. And maybe 10% of these transactions are with the same, within the minority, and the others are intergroup. Okay, so you can, each transaction can be cooperative, which is good because you save transaction cost. Or non-cooperative, which is not good, but still you gain something from a market transaction. Okay, so you have this incentive structure of prisoner's dilemma. Cooperation, you get B, which is lower than A, meaning that you have an incentive to deviate from cooperation. The non-cooperative or market payoff is C, and the minimum payoff when you cooperate but your partner does not, then you have the minimal payoff D. So all the model is to explain, I will skip that relatively quickly, that the incentive to deviate, you see the A over there. Here is an increasing function of the relative size of the group. This is a well-known argument in economics about the collective action, which is more difficult in bigger groups. Okay, we normalize the market payoff to 1, tentatively at least, and the minimal payoff to 0. We assume that when you are intra-group, the transaction is between two people from the same group, there is some altruism. Alpha is the altruistic parameter, meaning that you will kind of discount your payoff from defecting, okay? You will, and in this case, if altruism is sufficiently high, then you will not choose to deviate from the cooperative agreement, okay? So based on this, what we say is that you can have a situation where there is solidarity, cooperation for trades within the minority, while you have no cooperation. This is market-based in intergroup trades, and also the majority is not cooperative. Okay, so based on, and this is also backed, of course, by historical evidence. And then The last thing we assume is that if someone with some characteristic gets a higher income just because there is cooperation in the intra-group transactions, then this creates hostility on the side of the majority group. Hostility meaning that you are ready to inflict a cost when you meet the member of the minority in the intergroup transactions. Okay, so based on all this, okay, so this is this hostility function H kicking in the market transaction for intergroup transactions. So based on all this game theoretical framework, I'm skipping this, okay. You have, I think, the nice, so assume now you have three different situations. Assume you have, you are a Jew, and you can live either in a rural era, R, in an urban era, or you can convert. These are the choices you are given. Assume you live in a rural era, then you can stay there. You will have the payoff IR, which is a weighted average of the payoff in your intra-group and intra-group transactions. In the rural era, you can move to the city where you have a payoff IU for urban, or you can choose to convert. You stay in the village, but you convert to Christianity or to Islam, depending on what the majority religion is. Okay, so the equilibrium in economics is that you have to equalize income or utilities across choices. Okay, this is what you see from this figure. Okay, this figure you have. This income there, I don't have a pointer, but I think you follow my finger. Okay, in the rural era, this one is the urban era, and the diagonal is just assuming a uniform distribution of the preferences for Judaism. And when you equalize, so this is the income that you get from when you are converted. Okay, so think that you equalize these three things, and this occurs for a level of income I star, when you will have this number of Jews in the rural area, this number in the urban area, and this number of people who will convert. Okay, so this is an equilibrium model based on a game theory incentive framework, and you equalize utilities across choices. Okay, very standard as an economic model. So then we have some predictions from this theoretical framework. So the first prediction is, assume there is an exogenous increase in hostility. Okay, the hostility becomes stronger. What do we predict? Then this will decrease the payoff from intergroup exchanges and will lower expected income in both rural and urban areas. Then you will have less Jews in both areas and more people who will convert. This is illustrated in this figure. You see that the number of converts moves from A to A prime, and you have, this is bigger because you have less rural and urban Jews, meaning more converts, okay, from the two. So that's one thing you can do with that. Then you can add a fixed cost to this framework. The fixed cost is, we know that because you have a minimal size, you need minyan, you need some public goods, synagogues, mikveh, whatever. Okay, a rabbi, a teacher, okay, all this is funded by the community, and so the smaller the community, the higher the cost per member. And when you have this, this generates a few additional predictions. This prediction, for example, the second lemma, that in a stable equilibrium, an era with a smaller absolute number of Gentiles, so a place which is smaller, will have a smaller percentage of Jews, okay? So the relative size of the Jewish community will be smaller when the city or the village is smaller. We prove this. We have some corollaries of these lemmas. One corollary, so it's another prediction, the Jews will tend to become urbanized more than the Gentiles. So this was common also already, present already in Bocchetti and Eckstein. And finally, that there will be eras in which Jews will not be present, especially in relatively smaller places. This is a consequence of the fixed cost. Okay. So, and finally, that an exogenous increase in hostility, but I said this already, I think, will decrease both. Now, this is another aspect, both the equilibrium size of the Jewish communities and the number of communities. Okay, so all this is generated by our theoretical framework. So if we would want to test, okay, this theoretical framework, what would be the ideal empirical setting? So what I'm presenting now is not really a test, but, you know, trying to say what are the historical facts that can be accounted for by this model, which have not been accounted for by previous theoretical explanations. So what would be the ideal empirical setting? The first thing we would like is a place at a time where there were no persecution by the religious or political authorities. Okay, this doesn't mean there was no hostility towards the Jews, but this hostility was in daily encounters between minority and majority members and not a persecution from above. Okay, so especially it would be good to have a place where Jews were protected by charters, for example. Okay, we also want a place where there are enough cities of diverse sizes for us to be able to say something about our predictions. And we would like also, ideally, an exogenous shock, which would translate it into a shock in terms of hostility. So all these conditions are not easy to gather, but we believe Provence is 14th century Provence is a good candidate. All these elements are present. Why? So the Provence was a comté, so kind of, you know, it was not part of the Kingdom of France. It was actually part of the Duché d'Anjou. And Jews were protected by a charter. They were also protected by a charter in the nearby Comté of Venaissin, where there was papal protection. This is a stable, institutionally unified, a relatively big area with cities of many different size. Very good data for these reasons here, that it was a country of statute law, huge amount of Latin notarial and judicial archives that have been well preserved. Especially we have very good tracks of the history of the Jews there from the 13th to the 15th century. As I said, diversity of large cities like Marseille, Arles, Aix, medium cities and small cities, and very good general demographic data, like the French demographer Baratier in the 50s and 60s, and also many, many studies, Yonkou being one, but there are many others, on the Jews of Provence during that period. And then finally, we also have an exogenous shock, which is the Black Death. It's reasonably exogenous, and unless we really believe that the Jews were responsible for that, it's exogenous. And it came to Europe through Marseille exactly in the middle of the 14th century, so it's a kind of historical natural experiment that we can use for identification. That's pushing things too much, but for saying something about the mechanism at work during in our context. So it's reasonably exogenous. A few words about the history of the Jews of Provence. It's an old history, already dating back to the Roman period. Benjamin of Tudela, for example, visited also many communities of Provence. The political context, as I said, is a context of relative stability. There are charters, the Jews are protected, they have civic rights, etc. They are affluent, there are many, very, very diverse in terms of occupations that they are doing. And we have good sources, especially fiscal sources, which are the ones used. So there are sources mainly through two types of taxes that were paid. One was the caste, but it was not paid by Jews for some reason. So it's a positive discrimination, maybe, rare enough to be mentioned. But the main source used by demographers is the alberg, which was paid nearly by everyone. The quest was not paid by 50% of the population. The alberg was paid, and not paid only by 20%. The really poor and destitute people only did not pay this tax, and we have records for the tax, so you can know through the names who was Jewish, who was not, and you have a very good sense of the size of the communities. Okay, so this is the result from Juliette's data collection of many, many different sources on the Jewish communities. What was the Jewish population of the various cities for which we can place a number? We know there are Jews in other places, but we don't have the exact number. So we have 25 communities at the beginning or during the first half of the 14th century for which we have a good sense of the Jewish population and what percent of the total population of the place they represent. So 25 observations is not much to do empirical analysis, but is enough to look at some style as fact. If we test, we do a regression, we see that, but it's not controlling for anything, it's just a statistical description, right? So we see that both the total population and the square of the population of the city are significant and positive. So this is exactly what I said, that there is a rule of proportionality between the size of the city and the size of the Jewish community, with more Jewish, bigger relative Jewish community in relatively bigger cities. So here there is anyway, so don't treat the first bullet point, except that for circa 1340, we have many communities, as you see in the table, of various sizes with this rule of proportionality. Then you have the Black Death, and then after the Black Death, what we know for more anecdotal evidence is that the number of communities is shrinking, and their relative size is shrinking as if, you know, this was driven by an hostility shock as we model here. And to conclude, maybe just a quotation from Maurice Kriegel, who wrote a book on the Jews of at the end of the Middle Ages in the Mediterranean Europe. Basically, this is just to say that he's saying exactly what we are insisting on, that if you look at the middle, en règle générale, so in general, the more a city is important, he's talking about the Jews of Provence, okay? In general, the more a city is important, the bigger its Jewish community, and the denser and the bigger the proportion of Jews compared to the total of the population. Then, at the end of the 14th century and beginning of the 15th century, the Jews of Provence, that at some point, at the beginning of the 14th century, were settled in more than 60 agglomerations, cities of the region. Then they regrouped themselves due to fear for their security only in the bigger cities and abandoned the secondary centers, with also that their relative size from other citations shrunk. Okay, so I'll conclude with this citation. Thank you.